الحمد لله وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أما بعد. The evidence suggests that there's quite a strong relationship between the extremist Sufi groups and extreme Shia groups. And where do they meet in their i'tiqad, in their creed? The evidence suggests that, for one, in some of the ways in which they share a commonality with this extremism is, number one, that there is a resemblance between them, for example, in the maratib al-sufiyya wa darajatihim, meaning that the Sufi, when you get into those extremists, we're not talking about someone who just has some light to sow of. We're talking about people who are really into a Sufi tariqah. You know, maybe they've made a bay'ah to a particular leader or a particular madhab, and they, you know, meaning a pledge of allegiance to them and to their imam, and that they believe that there are different levels of in-depthness and in-tuneness that you can come with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to such a degree that some of them believe that you, after a certain point of dhikr and remembering Allah, that you no longer need Allah, or that you've become one with Allah. And this aqidah is called wahdata wujud, meaning that Allah is everything. These people have reached to such an extent of extremism in belief, and that they left the fold of Islam, and they believe that they no longer, that they are one with Allah. And there's so much evidence to suggest this. Go back to the books, look at the books, those books that possibly might be translated into English about Ibn Arabi and others. And you'll find many people who hold this i'tiqad in this day and age as well. Another way in which these extreme Shia and Sufi groups resemble one another is that there is ghulu or extremism with regards to Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. This is in the part of the Shia. The Shia, those Shia groups, of course we're not talking about all Shia. We're talking about those, especially the Rafida, and those people who have more disbelief than the Jews and the Christians, as Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said, that these people who reach this level of disbelief and extremism, they say that Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu shares in rububiyyah with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he has some aspects of lordship, that he determines and decrees and the qadr returns to him radiallahu ta'ala anhu. But this is false, and Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu himself is far removed from this khubb and khabith i'tiqad, this filthy and evil, wicked, innovated belief. And we say this with all respect. In fact, the way I'm speaking is, I'm trying to be as academic as possible. I'm not cursing anyone as far as an individual, and I'm not threatening anyone, but rather we're just bringing the facts that this is the most filth that even the pigs, when they urinate in their stalls, cannot come up with a greater filth than this kind of filthy belief when someone commits shirk to this level and to an extremism with their saints, in revering their saints and revering prophets and revering sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in wa sallallahu wa sallam ala kulluhum, that when they reach this level of extremism, to where they resemble the Catholics who revere their saints and worship their saints and make tawbah and repentance to their saints, then you know they have a problem. And you know they have nothing to do with Islam and they're outside the fold of Islam. وَعِيَادَ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. So another which way in which they resemble, the Shia and the Sufis resemble one another, is you'll find that a lot of the Rafida and their imams, they claim to know the knowledge of the unseen and to ascend to the skies and know the secrets of the heavens and the earth and so forth. And we have experienced so many of people amongst the extreme Sufis who say the same thing, who say that, hey, you know, our imam, Sheikh Nazim or Sheikh so-and-so, he knows the unseen. He knows knowledge that, hey, no one's going to know. You're not going to know it from the Quran, no matter how much you memorize and how much tafsir you read, and no matter how much your understanding could be taken from the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, you'll never have the knowledge of our imam or our particular sheikh or our imam. This resembles the Rafida, because the Rafida also believe that Khomeini and their other imams have knowledge of the unseen. And subhanAllah, what strikes me is very strange is how anyone, being amongst the Rafida, because they tend to listen to my videos and then curse me afterwards, that how, in all honesty, regardless if you think I'm a Wahhabi, you think that we are this, you think we're this, but just be honest with yourself. Are you a Muslim? And do you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, the only one worthy of worship? Or is your imam that important to you that you not only declare allegiance to him, but you believe that he is infallible? You believe that you can bring young girls to these imams, and these imams, these wicked, innovated kafirs, can make zina with these girls. A'udhu billah min dhalika. What kind of filthy, filthy i'tiqad is this? And you know it's true. Go back to your own books. Go back to the sources. Go back to Al-Kafi, which is one of the main pillars of the books of the Rafida. Wa'yadhu billah minhum. So this is another which way that we find that the extreme Sufis and extreme Rafida, that they resemble one another, is they they claim to know knowledge of the unseen, when Allah has freed as declared all throughout the Quran that this knowledge, this ilm al-ghayb, that we believe in it, but we only have a little knowledge of it. Even the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam only know a little bit of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to him through revelation. Salawatu Rabbi wa salamu alayhi. Another way in which these groups resemble one another is in i'tiqad fi ismat al-a'imma wa awliya, is that they believe that they have this as a part of their creed. Now ask yourself, do you believe your imam and your sheikh is perfect? That they're infallible, they have no sins, and they make no mistakes? And that awliya so-and-so, the Abdul Qadir Jilani, or Imam Tijani, or so-and-so, the Naqshbandi Tariqah, do you believe that they were infallible? And that they are awliya, that they're on such a level, such a high level, that they never died, and that they were on such a high level that you can make supplication to them? If you do, you better check your creed. And don't refer to yourself as Muslim with this creed. This is ba'id al-Islam. It's so far from Islam. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you know, iyyakum al-ghulu. He said, beware of ghulu. And don't make me like the Christians made Jesus alayhi salatu wa sallam, the son of Maryam. Don't make that resemblance and worship me and go to that level and make rububiyah with me, making me a lord with Allah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said also in another hadith, when the man said, inshallah wa shit, he said, if Allah wills and you will. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam freed himself from this. He said, basically, that do you make a resemblance between me, you made me as a partner with Allah? He was angry, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, freeing himself from lordship. So if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wasn't a lord, then how is it that the Shia can make Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu a lord? And how is it that those extreme Sufis could make Abdul Qadir al-Jilani a lord by supplicating to him? Or Abdullah al-Hariri, al-Habashi, how could they take him to such a level where they're going to go to his grave and supplicate to him? He couldn't even stop his own death. He couldn't stop the wrinkles from in his skin, and he can't stop his body from deteriorating. وَعِيَادِ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ضَلَالٍ. So this is an extremely important thing to be aware of, that that there's a relationship with the extreme Sufis and the extreme Shia, is that they believe their imams and their awliya to be on such a high level that they are free from mistakes, and that they use them to make tawassul, that they pray to them, they supplicate to them when living and dead, going to their graves. Ask yourself, what kind of Islam is this? Ask yourself about these resemblances. And if you are confused about these issues, do your best. Go back to Allah. Ask Allah for guidance. Make tawbah from this belief and come to Islam. into Islam, in totality, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. And Allah only accepts Islam. So fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and remove yourself from these evil beliefs. وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد.